Penguin Random House Audio presents The Making of Incarnation by Tom McCarthy. Read for you by Ben Onwukwe.
For Isadora and Alexis Lemon McCarthy. Incarnation is our grace. It alone creates color, touch, distance, and music, the lithe resilience of the flesh, and the desire that will not halt. Denis de Rougemont. Prolegomenon. On the dynamic properties of waves in periodic systems. From the S-Bahn, through shuttling latticework of tree branch and bridge truss, you glimpse it just below Tiergarten as you travel east to west, or west to east, a five-story blue hulk. The building levitates unnaturally above the ground, jacked up on two giant tubular pink ducts that protrude and curl downwards from its sides, then join together at its base, as though it were a crab reared up in fear or anger, or some kind of mating ritual. What is it? It's the Verruschanstalt für Wasserbau und Schiffbau, Research Institute for Hydraulic Engineering and Shipbuilding, outpost that Technische Universität Berlin has maintained through a royal lease that somehow weathered wars, land value hikes and all the rest, on this small, elongated island around which the Landwehr Canal bifurcates into sluiced sections before merging back into a single flow, out of whose grain all knots, spirals, and other traces of past interruption or obstruction have been smoothed. Or, scanned at a res higher than most S-Bahn riders have at their disposal, it's a complex of buildings slotted into one another. The eye-catching crustacean ones, the Umlauf and Kavitationstank UT2, its looping claw a conduit capable of pumping 3,300 tons of water round and round at 9 meters per second, perfect for wake field and cavitation research, forced motion and propulsion tests, and like manner of fluid dynamic inquiry. There, amidst the roar of a 2-megawatt ship diesel engine and vibrations of the vast pump switchblades that shake wall and floor's sheet panels, dramas of rarefaction and compression, cyclic stress, and supercavitation play themselves out on demand, putting model hulls, rudders, and propellers through their paces, coaxing from these inception numbers and erosion progress rates. Below this towering monster, strewn about its feet like strips of food or half-spawned offspring, lie a series of long, flat hangars. It's in one of these, the one housing the Seegangsbecken, the sea-keeping basin or wave generator, intermittently replenished, like the UT2, by the same liquid mass diverted from and eventually released back into the Landwehr, and thence onwards to the Spree, that today's action is taking place. Here Neptune's wrath is about to be unleashed on a platform supply vessel, an anchor-handling tug and two oil rigs. Resident technician Arda Gocek, Dipl-Ing, VWS's keeper of the sea, stands at the basin's absorption end, moving his thumb and fingers round a MacBook's glide pad, scaling metrics, modifying ratios, adjusting up or down wave height and stroke length, characteristic and gravitational velocities. When the profile on his screen, the rhythm of its curves and intervals, aligns with that of today's target values, Gocek's hand breaks contact with the laptop, hovers an inch or two above its keyboard, while his eyes cross-check the graphic contours one last time, then falls decisively back down on the spacebar. More than 100 meters away, at the basin's far end, the wave generation mechanism groans. Drive arms, pulleys and linkage arms, drive pegs, flange bearings and connecting rods stir, clasp and thrust, shunting a slanted flap repeatedly against the water's bulk. And then it comes down the long, narrow stretch, peak doubling, the ceiling's intermittent strip lights one after the other, raising each inverted spectral light line up towards its source, before the trough swallows the reflection once more in its darkened vortex, the first wave. It's followed by another, and another, and another, soaking the green tiles along the basin's sides, redrawing the same high water mark over and over with complete precision. Do the boats and platforms sense them coming? Of course not. All propagation vectors of the medium they sit in have been plotted here, phase boundaries and resonant frequencies rendered transparent. There's no wiggle room for ambiguity, and even less for fantasy. Yet Gocek, still, each time he watches replica cities, dams or cruise ships, harbour walls or wind farms in the propagation section in the last, contracting moments just before the first wave hits, fancies that he senses, in the model's very composition, the clinging together of their atoms, an increased level of concentrated stasis, a tensing, almost, as though they were bracing themselves, as though, somehow, they knew. Now the waves are among them, tossing and convulsing them, sending them veering, laterally and vertically, longitudinally, transversally, and every which way in between, down paths that seem quite random, but in fact are not at all. That's the whole point. Cameras at the basin's sides are tracking and translating every heave and surge and sway, identifying, within the furious tangle of the lines, some kind of pattern to be viewed both retro and prospectively, its fuzz transmuted into clean parameters that, once modelled, can be not only scaled back up for the benefit of future offshore installation planners, but also traversing their own vectors of circulation and displacement, transferred and extrapolated and fed into who knows what. Over the next 16 months, today's work-through data will be brought to bear on fields as variant as infrasonics and seismocartography, the study of germ convection around airline cabins, and the spread of rumour over social networks. Things are connected to other things, which are connected to other things. Yesterday, 103 Asian miners died in a methane explosion. A small South American state underwent a coup. A large pod of whales beached itself off Western Europe's coastline. The pages of Gocek's newspaper, lying open on a stool beside a half-drunk coffee cup, rustle as he climbs a nearby stepladder, borne upwards in his slipstream. From on high, the technician watches the boats lurching and bobbing drunkenly amidst the swells and currents, hurtling past the battered reefs of the oil platform's legs and anchors. The elevation calms him. He's above the struggle, uninvolved. Visions of the Bosphorus drift across his mind's back reaches, morphing through various formations, less a place glimpsed from car windows and mosque terraces on holidays, extended family visits, than a vague ancestral memory, an idea. The wave generation mechanism groans. The flap shunts onto the same rhythm. The pillow block journal bearings, holding the drive shaft in place, need lubricating. Gocek can tell that from the note of irritation in its tone. On the smooth stretches of the basin's water, before the models break its surface, there's an outer coat of oil and dirt, a no-man's land littered by corpses of the insects lured there by the mirrored swathes of airspace and bright rafters, the false promise of companionship. The anchor-handling tug, its prow of hardened paraffin, has got itself wedged in one of the oil rig's leg struts. Computer modelling won't show you everything. Sometimes you have to actually do it. Make a little world, get down amidst dumb objects and their messiness. From the basin's exterior, where it rests on J-hooks beside coils of hosing, wiring, torn canvas and string, Gocek lifts a pike pole and leans in over the edge, trying to prise the vessel free. His right foot raised behind him for stability.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.